morning. It's Saturday, the 14th of January, 2017. Welcome along, boys and girls. I nearly had to run that three-minute thing again then. I sat here like a minute ago and started the old sneezing. That's a thing now, actually. I've noticed that. While I'm sitting there and you've got that three-minute thing, rather than sneezing at the beginning of the show, I now sneeze when that three-minute thing's coming on. So that saves you. Perhaps you feel that you missed the sneezing, do you? Perhaps you feel you missed the sneezing at the beginning of the show. I don't know. Let's say good morning to the... Gosh... Isn't there a lot of you? Good morning to the early people who are with us right at the start of the show today. Wendy's there. Good morning, Gustav. Gustav, who appeared last night at Central Station and was the only... He squeezed my bum last night. He squeezed my bum while I was standing at the bar. You know, without permission. He says, I'm going to squeeze your bum tonight. And I said, why is that then? He said, well, you said that on your show. I said, yeah, but that was just for Christmas. And then, without saying anything, suddenly this hand came down, which I enjoyed very much. Thank you, Gustav. I just wish more people would do that. Thank you, Gustav. Good morning to Terry Turner this morning. Morning, Terry. Terry H is there as well in Leeds. Hello, Terry H. Danny Davies in Manchester. Yakka da gang. Yakai da gang. Now, what is this like, you know, young person's talk, Danny? Is this something that my nephew would understand, Jimmy? Yakki da gang. Is that some sort of foreign thing, dear? What is yakki da gang? That's got to be a young person's thing, isn't it? Huh? That we don't understand. It's like another language. If you, I don't know if you've, any of you still got Periscope on your phones, but you turn that on late at night and look for anyone in London, and they all speak like that, and it, and there's no the, it's da, da. There's no the. They can't speak. It must be a young person thing. Yakka da gang. Very strange. Good morning to Jerry. Morning, Jerry. Gustav is having his coffee. Oh, I don't like coffee, Gustav. I'm not a keen coffee person. Thank you, Joey. Good morning to Carl Rex Mawson. Good morning, sir. Yes, he must be getting ready for work later on. Peter Hyde is with us this morning. Good morning, Peter. Matt Joplin's there. Morning, you good-looking lot. Are you referring to me? Oh, no. Okay, all right. Thank you very much. We are like one big happy family here. You're quite right, Danny. Everyone's talking to each other. Good morning to Ray Reynolds, who joins us. Morning, Ray. What a fantastic night last night at the karaoke. I have to say, that must have been the busiest Friday yet. I don't know where they're all coming from. We're getting an awful lot now of young people in on a Friday who are all up for it, as in singing. You know, they're all up for it. And coming on the stage and singing their songs. And it's just an absolutely packed night. Packed on Friday night. So that's fantastic news. It really is. I must say, the governor came up to us at the end last night at 12 o'clock. Now, we have to finish the karaoke at 12. It's a sound issue. Okay, we have to finish at 12. He said, well, could you stay there and DJ for a bit longer? Honestly, I've been standing on the stage for like 4 hours. And like, oh, what you don't see, I'll let you into this secret. What you don't realise is that actually, come finishing time, I am shattered. I'll basically be standing on the stage for 4 hours doing a show, and I am shattered. And I go out the door, thank you, bye-bye, everyone, bye-bye. I go around the corner, and I get into my car, and I'm like, oh, and I'm like this. Just for a few minutes, I'm like this in my car. This is no word of a lie. I'm like this. Like this, and eventually I hit the. What have I done? I thought I'd done something. I hit the on button in my car because there's no key in my car. Oh no! Very modern Toyota hybrid RAV4. You push the on button, but you don't think you can break into the car now and just turn it on by pushing a button. You've got to have the key nearby. I don't know how that works. The key has to be in the certain vicinity of the engine, right? And then you push the on button and it just starts. Would there be a battery in that or what? How does that work? Because what if the battery goes flat? Then you can't start the car, can you? Or maybe there's a way around that. I don't know. That's a bit worrying, isn't it? What if the battery dies in the car? I better look that up. Do you ever read the instruction book that comes with a car? Only if you can't find out something to work. Lord, I tell you what I did the other day, actually. I was driving in and I couldn't, it's an automatic, so there's no gears. And I couldn't understand. It was making a bit of a racket, as in fast revs. And I'm thinking, come on, change gear. And I went ever such a long way and I just couldn't get any faster. I thought, oh, something's gone wrong with this. And then I realised, I looked down and the gear stick, if you move it slightly to the right, then it can be like you've got gears. So you pull this lever back to change up or down, one or the other, and then you push it forward to change down. When I say pull it forward, you only got to tap it like that and it returns to its position. So you tap and it goes like that, a little bit like that. Only not, you know, only just like little bit. And I'd knocked it into there, so I must have been in a high gear or a low gear or something like that. And I shoved it back over to automatic and everything was fine again. Last night's journey, not bad at all getting into work last night. An hour and a half, which I was very, very pleased with. Nice hour and a half into work. Lovely, lovely. And the thing is with those karaoke desks, it's not just about the singing. It's about the friendship that gathers between all these people, a little bit like yourselves chatting away on here this morning. But that's what it's all about. It's not just about the singing, you see what I mean? So a fantastic night last night. I'm very, very pleased with that indeed. I've got some news stories to read for you this morning. Johnny Key's with us this morning. Good morning, Johnny. Nice to see you. Yaka Da is Welsh, apparently. Oh, of course, you're from Wales, aren't you? Yaka Da. Am I saying that okay as like a Welsh accent? Yaka Da, Yaka Da. Does that sound okay, Danny? I do hope so. You will be able to call in a little bit later on, boys and girls. Not at the moment. Gustav, who squeezed my bum last night, says, very tight. I thought it would be like a bag of spammers. How rude. How rude. I'm glad you like the shirt, Wendy. I think this is one I bought myself. It's a little bit tight around the stomach at the moment. Even tighter than it was last night. I've got sort of a good bit of news and a bad bit of news in the same sentence. The good bit of news is I went to the BP garage on the way home last night. What did I go in there for? I went in for something specific. I can't remember. Oh, yes, for a small loaf of bread, for a small Hovis loaf of bread. Because suddenly, last night, as requested by me, Maureen, who brings me in a little packed box of food, I requested that I could have sandwiches again. Because she sent me a little text and said, is the food still okay? I said, well, actually, I'm starting to eat the bread again now. Not too much, mind. Eat the bread. Because we don't think that was the cause of the acid problem. I don't think it was now. You know, because actually, in the last few weeks, I haven't had the problem. And I have been having a little bit of bread here and there. So it doesn't seem to bother. So Maureen last night bought me in sandwiches in bread. Oh, my word. They were absolutely delicious. And it was the bread that made it. And it was all soft and lovely. And at the end of the night, she told me it was Hovis wholemeal bread with seeds. So on the way home tonight, or last night, I popped into the BP because it's got a Marks and Spencer's thing attached to it as well. And I didn't have any Hovis, but I found Marks and Spencer's wholemeal bread with seeds. So I bought some of that back. And the good news is... da 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 da! I didn't buy any crisps last night. A round of applause for Chris Reardon, thank you very much. No crisps were purchased by me last night at Marks and Spencer's. The bad news is I bought two bags of Doritos. Now, it was only supposed to be one bag, but of course they've got that tempting old offer on. You buy one bag for 99 pence or two bags for £1.40 and you save the money. I mean, you can't turn down an offer like that. But more good news, I got home, done the cat tray when I got in. She'd left a little present for me in the cat tray. In the cat tray today. Well done, Katie the cat. Shame it wasn't in the same place this morning. But never mind. Last night, a small present in the cat tray, which I emptied. Had a cup of tea and only one bag of Doritos. So there's another bag downstairs waiting for me. A little bit later on. Maybe I might go swimming later. I haven't decided yet. And then I might have them after swimming. So thank you very much for those. Yes, so that's the good news and the bad. I know, Peter. I know. Blooming Doritos. I don't know. Is one worse than the other? I mean, are crisps or Doritos, which one is worse for you? That's the question. I mean, they do... I love the smell. The cheese Doritos. They're the ones I like, Peter. Mmm, very nice. Terry H says, I wish someone would make meals for me. Well, I'm sure you can find someone, Terry, lovey. There are people who would make meals for you. There's McDonald's, there's Burger King, there's Subway, an order. What is it with Subway? How did we ever get conned into buying sandwiches that haven't got butter on them? You know when you make a sandwich at home, right? Say you do, I don't know, a cheese and onion sandwich, or a tomato sandwich, or cucumber sandwich, or dead animal sandwich, which I know a lot of you like there. You love a good old dead animal. No, no, it's not a dead animal. It's ham. Oh no, it's not a dead animal. It's beef. Yes, it's a dead animal. So you know when you make your dead animal sandwiches at home, do you put butter on there? Or margarine? I bet you do, don't you? So how is it we all got conned into going into Subway where they don't put butter on there? Have you ever asked? Have you ever asked? Have you ever gone into Subway and said, oh, can I have butter on there, please? I wonder what they'd say. I'm going to try that next time. Next time I go into Subway, because I do quite like, in Subway, a toasted cheese footlong honey roast or whatever it's called. Honey oat bread, something like that. And that's the other thing. They haven't got any whole meal in there, have they? Oh, have you got a whole meal one? And then they get the sheet out. And they don't know what it is. They don't know what it is. One of them must be whole meal, surely. But no butter. You've got to go in there. Next time you go to Subway, ask them to butter the bread first. That will really confuse them. You know what they're like. Gustav says, a sandwich traditionally only has butter if it has... Oh, here we go, listen. Oh, he's been Googling the blooming thing now. Googling the thing. A sandwich traditionally only has butter if it has salad, like lettuce, to stop the liquid from penetrating the bread. Is that right? Well, why comes we've put butter on everything, dear? And none of that nasty margarine. I've stopped eating margarine. And I'll tell you why. Because I've noticed if you don't put the margarine in the fridge, it starts growing stuff. Have you noticed that? Mould is growing in the margarine. And I got fed up scraping the bit of mould off the top and then having to wash that knife before I took the nice margarine underneath. What do you mean, didn't you chuck it away? No, it was all right underneath. But I don't do it anymore. Butter doesn't seem to do that. Sometimes, if it's very hot in the kitchen, it might melt a bit, but it solidifies again. You never get anything growing out of it, or I've never seen anything growing out of butter, so I've stopped eating margarine. It must be full of bacteria, dear. Full of it, dear. Like myself, full of viruses. Yes. Wendy says, I haven't used marge on a sandwich since I was about 10 years old. What, you have dry bread, Wendy? On a sandwich? Dry bread? Well, you don't put anything on it. So you would have, I don't know, bread, dead animal, then bread. Or bread, dead animal, lettuce, cucumber, tomato, chopped up peppers, and then a bit of bread again. Or do you have bread, dead animal, lettuce, dead animal, cucumbers? Because some people like a triple-decker thing, don't they? Yes. Terry says, I don't either eat marge or butter these days. Gosh, really? Wendy says it as well. Look, most people don't use marge or butter. Well, you've all been conned by people like Subway. That's why, dear. You must keep up your Britishness, dear. You need to be more British. Stop doing what everyone else is doing. Do what we've always done before. Land of hope and glory, mother of the sea. Yes, keep it up. Reintroduce butter into your diets of sandwiches. That's what you need. Thank you very much. Johnny says butter is a natural product. A little bit like myself. All natural. Look, every line is still there. Nothing is being diluted by Botox or anything like that. There was some woman in the paper the other day who now, apparently, she doesn't use Botox. She injects the collagen from dead horses into her face. Do you think Camilla Parker Bowles does that? She injects stuff, fat, from dead horses into her face. What is it with these people? It's all very strange and mysterious. It really is. Danny says, my nana butters burger buns with Oh, no, I don't butter burger buns. No. But that is a sort of nan thing to do, isn't it? And let's be honest, boys and girls, no one but no one ever criticises their nana. Never. Never, never, never. Yes. Ray Reynolds says, I can't believe it's not butter or butter me up from Chris's favourite supermarket, Tesco's. I don't go to Tesco's, dear. Waitrose. If I'm absolutely desperate, I'll go to Sainsbury's, which is just up the road, but I hate it in there. I hate it. The stuff. And when you go on the self-service thing in Sainsbury's, they are watching you like a hawk. There's some old bag or some bloke standing at the end there, watching everything that's going on, like I'm going to nick something. I'm a Waitrose customer, dear. We don't steal. It's as simple as that. Beep, beep, beep. And all that business. Oh, dear. They've got the self-service guns now in Sainsbury's. God knows how much stuff they're having nicked out of there now by the dodgy people that go in there. All right. Johnny says, please look at the rest of my previous message. It's gone. It goes. There's so many coming up. It disappears eventually. Alfie calls you all devil worshippers. Here we are. Butter is a natural product. Margarine has almost the same constituents as paint. Really? Oh, I'm not surprised. Oh, it does though. Stuff grows out of margarine. You must have seen it before. Awful, just awful. Right, we've got a couple of stories to do here now. Now, we're talking about butter and sandwiches there. What about sushi? Do you like sushi? I mean, I look at it and it looks just awful. Little bits of dead rolled up fish. But it's not the fact that it's a dead animal. That's neither here nor there in this case. I don't like the smell. It just looks foul. Wow. Well, we got a few stories coming across there today, boys and girls. Look at this. This was in yesterday's Daily Mail. And it says, it's the trendy lunch of choice for everyone from office workers to Hollywood film stars. They're all eating it up, especially the young people. I noticed that. The young people seem to love sushi. It's, let's be honest, you know, these places are packed. Even, and I hate to say this, the local, very British Waitrose that we have here in Bracknell got rid, get this. I mean, I couldn't believe it. They've got rid of the cakes and bread counter and they put in no other than a bloomin' sushi bar. A sushi bar. And it's all very clean, you know, they've all got their little hats on and working with this dead fish stuff, making little things, little pretty things and little polystyrene boxes and things and all on the shelves. There's usually a bloke out the front who's got trays full of the stuff that people... Do you know, I haven't fired up the phone number thing, have I? Oh, you silly boy, Chris. Just a moment. Let me just fire that. I hope no one's been trying to call in because you wouldn't have been able to get through. I haven't switched it on yet. Anyway, so yes, they're all out the front with demonstrations. Would you like to try some of this, sir? Would you like to try some of that? No, I wouldn't like to try any of that. It's evil. And they're yakking it up, aren't they? Oh, no, that sushi stuff is not for me. But anyway, the story goes, but the oh-so-healthy sushi is actually damaging our seas. Not that you're bothered. You're not bothered, are you, about the environment? Doesn't bother me. Doesn't bother me. Nope, doesn't bother you, does it? Anyway, leading marine biologists have warned. They say that the fashion for the fish dish is not only causing a massive decline in the number of tuna in oceans, but also filling us, as in you, not me. You are being filling your little bodies with microbeads. Microbeads. You don't know what they are, do you? They're tiny little bits of plastic. All this plastic that gets shoved everywhere, including in the sea. You don't think it stays like a bottle, do you? No. over a long period of time, it gets broken down into these tiny little bits of plastic, which little things in the sea eat, and then you eat the things that are in the sea. It's ending up in your body. I mean, have you noticed that sometimes you're walking around and one of your arms is a bit heavy? That's because that arm is now full up with plastic. That is what it is. And there's only one way to deal with it. You have to chop the arm off. Chop it off, dear. Chop it off. Make an appointment at your GP surgery now. If you're lucky, you'll get one for sort of April or May. It's all going terribly wrong in this country, isn't it? You'll get one for April or May, at which point they'll refer you to a hospital. You should be able to get in there by September, and they'll do the operation sometime in 2020 to remove, by which time the other arm will have filled up with plastic from microbeads as well. Horrendous. They say that the fashion for the fish dish is not only causing a massive decline in the number of tuna in oceans, but also filling us up with those nasty little microbeads. This sushi market is worth £69 million a year in the UK. But it's just horrible. I mean, just awful. Microbeads are poison pills which soak up all the pollutants and then are consumed by the little fish, which are then eaten by tuna. And guess what eats the tuna? You! Oh, yes, whether it's fresh or other. You've got a few in the old cupboard now, haven't you? You got one of those tins with that key that you turn. And the metal sort of scrolls up like that. It like rolls around. And then you get that bit of tuna out and you start it. Or pilchards. Oh, my God. Disgusting things. Pilchards. My mum used to love those. She'd have them on toast. Pilchards. Oh, or on a salad. Oh, years ago, when I was a child, my mum, on a Saturday night, we'd all have Saturday. It would be a different meal from every night of the week. And I would sit on the floor. I had this metal tray, right, with two legs either side. And I would like to sit on the floor and have my tea. And she'd in would come baked beans and sausages on a piece of French stick like that. Oh, it was delicious. And I would have that and followed by some cakes all on a plate. Why else did I have? I think that's all I... And crisps. I would have crisps and cup of tea. That's what I had. And that I would sit on the floor and we'd watch the telly. Bruce Forsyth's Generation game. Before that, we'd have Final Score after Grand. So they'd have Grandstand. Then they'd have another programme like... Oh, the Pink Panther. That was it. They'd have Grandstand, then the Pink Panther, then Final Score. Then I think it was Bruce Forsyth's Generation game. Then, possibly Doctor Who. Then it would be something like The Duchess of Duke Street. And that was the Saturday night schedule on BBC One. Colour. Oh, it was fabulous. Anyway, so we'd have our tea sort of round about when Doctor Who was on. And I'd be on there. And then Mum would bring hers in, which would always be some sort of salad with perhaps ham or pilchards. And I would watch my mum get this can of pilchards and undo it. And these things, oh, they were disgusting. Covered in tomato sauce would come out of the tin. Oh! Not my cup of tea at all. Or, of course, you can buy the other ones that are... the other ones have got... what are they in? Brine. I think it's brine, isn't it? Which is actually doesn't look as bad as the one, you know, the ones in tomato sauce look like they've been hacked to pieces and it's all blood in there. But of course, it's not his tomato sauce, not my cup. So we don't like sushi. And there was another story, actually, in the Daily Mail, which I was researching today, boys and girls, researching, which came out a while ago. And this is about a Chinese man who went to his doctor with stomachache and itchy skin. Okay, scans revealed his entire body. Now, if you're a sushi eater, you want to listen to this. You make sure you listen to this. Scans revealed his entire body had been infected. I like that word, don't you? Infected. His entire body had been infected with tapeworm. Oh, God. Worms were crawling about inside his body. Doctors say it was due to the large amount of raw fish he had eaten. Although, quite honestly, I don't think it would make any difference whether you ate a large amount or not. Once there's a tapeworm in you, they start multiplying, don't they? Can they multiply on their own, or do they need another one, like a boy tapeworm? And a female even worse? A male tapeworm and a female in your own body doing it together, making small tapeworms. Oh, I wondered what that movement feeling was in my stomach. My stomach's making a lot of noise this morning, it was, after my breakfast of porridge this morning. I had porridge this morning. Cases such as this have been increasing due to the soaring popularity of, any guesses? Go on, take a wild guess. A stab in the dark. Sushi. Sushi. So you remember now. Next time you go into one of those awful restaurants where the food comes round on a little... I mean, it's like the bloody Generation Game, dear. Do you remember the tune? And then all these prizes would come past you on a conveyor belt. Well, that's what it's like in a sushi restaurant. Except in my case, if I was sitting there in a sushi restaurant watching the prizes come by, I'd rather win nothing at all. Awful stuff. Awful. Johnny says, in the 50s, Saturday tea was usually around a coal fire, listening to radio programmes like Journey into Space. I don't know that one. I don't know that one at all, no. Hello to Joss, who's watching from a small town in Australia. Good morning, Joss. Oh, got itchy nose. It's this side today. Got itchy nose. Good morning, Joss. Nice to see you, sir. Let's have a look. Elaine says, sorry, Chris, the stream is a bit choppy. Chop, 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 chop. Are we chopping around tonight? Is it all right for everyone else? I hope you can see us okay tonight, boys and girls. Anyone else having a little problem with the stream? Today. Wendy says, didn't you read something on your show about microbeads a while ago? I'm sure I remember it. Yes, indeed, I did. Although I can't remember what it was. It might have been another sushi story. It could well have been. Or it's not, I don't suppose for one moment, it's just sushi. I guess cod eat it. You know, haddock, that's a very popular fish in this country, isn't it? So I suppose it could be other things as well. Good morning to Mark Larney. Good morning, Mark. And James Palmer. Hello, James. Long time no see. You've been hiding from me, James. We're still here chatting away. Year 11. We're at year 11 now. I've been talking rubbish now for 11 years. My Lord. Alfie says, I keep saying dear. I'm sorry about that. I've got a little habit, a nasty habit of saying dear all the time. So that's a sushi. Now, do you like sushi? What is it about sushi that you like? That's the question I am asking you this morning to start with, boys and girls. I would like to know if you like sushi, good experiences, bad experiences, anything like that. If you have an experience on sushi, I'd love you to call in and have a little chat it with me this morning, boys and girls. The number, if you're watching the show live, has now appeared on your computer or mobile phone screens, or those of you who have hooked me up to a large television set somewhere in the house, the number will have appeared there at the bottom of the screen. It is 020-8144-3477. It's always better to call in than send a message. Sometimes I can't get round to all the messages, and the way they flash up, sometimes you miss some of them as well. So if you put messages on there and it hasn't been read, put it on again. I might see it the second time, or the third, or the fourth. Okay? So if you want to call in about sushi, feel free to do so. Oh, Danny Davies is quick on the phone this morning. Good morning, David, in Manchester. Oh, Danny? Now, why can't... Oh, no, has that dropped out? That call's dropped out, I think. I think that's dropped out. Try that again, Danny. I thought he was calling in then. Did I hit a wrong button? I might have cut you off accidentally then, Danny. Sorry. Try again. There we are. Let's try that again. Good morning, Danny.
Good morning.
Oh, that's better. Yes. What happened then? Did you hang up or was it me?
It was you.
Oh, you think so, do you? I rarely make a mistake, Danny, as you well know, dear.
Yeah, we're just talking about stomach problems.
Well, briefly. If you don't mind me saying so, you sound a lot more lively than you did the other night. It was like I thought I was talking to a corpse the other night when you rang in, dear.
Well, it's daytime. Everyone's awake, aren't they?
Daytime. So I use that term very loosely, my love, away. My nephew won't be awake at this time on a Sunday. I tell you that now after he's been out getting drunk all night. Anyway, go on.
Over the last few days, I don't eat sushi, by the way. I can't stand it.
Oh, what? Why don't you like it? Have you ever tried it?
No, it's just a look.
Has anyone ever said to you, oh, you don't know unless you try it? And you know what, Danny? You do know, don't you? You do know that actually you don't want to eat that stuff without even tasting it.
Yeah, and there's certain foods I wouldn't even go near. Like, I don't eat really hot curries because I know I won't like them. I'm not going to try them if I know I'm not going to like them. So that's the way I look at it.
Have you ever... go on, yeah.
But the whole thing about this, you know, when the stomach problems, over the last few days, my stomach has been cramping quite a lot.
Oh.
Last thing before I go to bed and first thing when I get up in the morning. So I'm not too sure, because I'm eating like my three meals a day, etc.
Oh, etc. Are you having more than three meals a day, lovey? Oh, yes. You're having a pasty as well, aren't you? And crisps and sweets and chocolates.
Yeah, three meals a day with a little bit of a bag of crisps here and there. But, you know, got to get rid of those Christmas chocolates somehow.
Well, I suppose. No, we'll throw them away, dear. Throw them away. Or take them to a home of some sort. Elderly people would be happy for you to take those sweets into their home. That could be used as a bingo prize. Five bingo. And nine, 59. Six and two, 62. Didn't you used to do bingo?
Yes, I used to do bingo when I was at Haven, didn't I?
Yeah, you did bingo, didn't you? Did you have the balls or just a button?
It was a computer program.
So it was just a button. Oh, no. That's not proper bingo, dear. You need one of those machines with the balls. They're ever so expensive, you know, if you buy them new.
I've never looked at buying one.
Very, very expensive to buy a bingo. They're actually called a blower machine. A bingo blower. Yes.
How much are they?
Oh, about £1,000. About £1,000 for a big one. You can get a smaller one. You can get them in America easier than you can get them here. But then, of course, you've got to get the damn thing home. I don't suppose in Ryanair they would allow you to bring a bingo thing on there.
I don't fly Ryanair.
Neither do I, thank you very much. British Airways or Virgin Atlantic only?
Virgin Atlantic for me.
So if I was to take you out for a free meal, it wouldn't be in a sushi place, no?
No, it would probably be pub grub.
Pub grub, oh, that sounds more like it. Chips and something. Mashed potato and something, yes?
Yeah, yes.
What the hell's that, dear?
It was my phone vibrating.
Well, would you not have your phone calls on while you're modulating with me, please? How rude is that?
I think it was an email.
God's sake, man.
But anyway, back to the whole stomach cramps.
Tell Dr. Chris.
So what I'm thinking is that I don't know what it is, because it seems to be last thing at night and first thing when I wake up in the morning. Because I'm not hungry, because it's not that grumbling noise. There's no noise. It's just cramp.
And how long's it been going on again?
It's probably started over the last week or so.
Oh, wow. I would go to the chemist and request information from them. Is it bad stomach? Is it a bit like that? Or is it just a mild thing?
It's not doubling over in pain kind of cramp. It's just an uncomfortable cramp.
Hmm. Well, I went to the doctors once with that. And he said, when does it happen? And I said, usually after a big meal. He said, you're eating too much. Honestly, that's what he said. So I cut down on the sizes of food. And then they stopped. So I don't know if it's that or not. Does it make a lot of noise, your tummy?
When I'm hungry, but I'm eating when I wake up, then I'm having lunch or whatever, and then dinner or tea, whatever you want to call it. So I'm having my three meals a day, and then I maybe have some supper before I went to bed, like, I don't know, a piece of toast or something.
Piece of toast. Well, I don't know. Maybe there is a doctor listening to this programme as we are broadcasting, boys and girls, who will be able to assist you in your ongoing... Have we got a doctor in the house? Doctor in the house. If there is, please call in. And you can talk directly to... Actually, we haven't tried that. Well, you can talk directly to Danny. Any doctors listening, please call in now. If you've got a phone number, 020-8144-377, local London number. Or maybe you've got Skype. If you've got Skype and you're anywhere in the world, it's a free call, of course. The Skype in is United Kingdom Talk. All one word, United Kingdom Talk. Joss says, could it possibly be appendicitis? Is the pain on the right-hand side, sort of around the belly button level, just below it?
Yeah.
Oh, could be appendicitis, dear. Or have you had that cut out?
No, I haven't had it cut out.
Well, mine's come out, so I don't... Well, actually, I do. I get sort of discomforts there sometimes. I'm sure stuff is getting blocked up as it goes around the tube. Maybe you've got a bit of appendicitis.
Well, I was thinking about phoning the out-of-hours doctors today and seeing if they can fit me in and having a good old gander and having a look, see what they can find.
Well, I think that would be a very good idea. I think you should ring them because you don't want that getting worse. That's the thing. You really don't want that worse. Alfie says, Dr. Chris Reardon behind the closed camera. Yes. Would you like me to do an investigation for you?
Well, you have a prod about...
I have a full set of rubber gloves downstairs if you need any help at all in that department. Oh, dear. You know those gloves that they use to birth horses? I've got a set of those downstairs just in case anyone gets caught short at some point.
Why would you need elbow length gloves?
Well, to check out your appendicitis. It's not near the end of the tube, dear. It's halfway up. You have to go all the way round.
Oh, Chris. This is supposed to be a light-hearted programme.
It is a light-hearted programme. Thank you very much.
But I think I shall call the doctors this morning. Well,
you
this
do
afternoon
that.
And see what they can say.
Do that and let us know what he says, because we're all worried about you now, aren't we? Hands up, who's worried about Danny? Oh, come on, put your hands up. It must be one or two. Oh, maybe not then, Danny, sorry.
Just you then.
Just me. I'm very, very concerned, Danny. You know that. Let us know what happens. Are you going to ring them now or after the show, preferably? We can't afford to lose viewers, dear. There's only 14 million now as it is.
Well, when I go back, it'll be 15 million.
Oh, well, thank God for that. Come on then, chop, chop, get back on there.
Right, so I shall listen to the advice of the 15 million people.
Yes, we're waiting for advice to flood in now, Danny. No, we haven't got any doctors watching because they would have rung in at that point, my love.
Right, well, I shall let you know on maybe tomorrow's show.
Please do.
How we get on.
How do you know there's going to be a show tomorrow? There might not be a show tomorrow. Might not be one. Well, all right, there will be. We'll do a live show tomorrow. We might do a night time live show tomorrow. I don't know. We'll see how the time goes. All right, Danny, good luck with your tummy, darling.
Thank you very much.
Cheerio.
Bye.
There's Danny calling in from Manchester on the show this morning, boys and girls. Alfie says, my highlights on a Sunday is the roast dinner and dad watching horse racing on Channel 4. Actually, you know the William Tell Overture? That was the answer to one of my questions when we were doing the music round at the quiz. I do a quiz every Wednesday at the King's Head Theatre Bar in Islington. And the music round, it's always different, the music round. And this week it was London Symphony Orchestra. That's what it was. And what I did was play 10 tracks as played by the London Symphony Orchestra. And you had to tell us what they were. They could have been pop songs, bits of classical, all sorts of different things. And that one, one of them was the William Tell Overture. It was good. Johnny says, the only problem here is that there are several other things I should be doing this morning. Well, you can do those while you're listening. Well, you don't have to watch, you know. You don't have to watch. That's okay. Just have us on In the background. That's what we need, in the background. Mark says, I can remember having chicken sandwiches with my mum and watching Poiroy. Poiroy. Is that Poirot? Is it Poiroy? On a Sunday evening when I was a child. Yeah, I remember Poiroy. I don't think I ever saw Poiroy, though. No, not sure I saw Poiroy. Alfie says, no fish food. You don't like the fish food either? No. No. Wendy says, I should keep on saying dear. Oh, well, I shall do. Dear, dear, dear. I should say dear as much as I want. If you don't mind, thank you very much. No. No doctors then. No one, no doctors can assist us in the inquiry of poor old thing. Poor old devil, dear. He's got a bad stomach this morning. So that's the sushi. Now, what else have we got here this morning? I want to read some messages from yesterday's show. JoAnna. Now, JoAnna, have you got the Christmas star that I sent you through the post yet? Has the Christmas star arrived that was sent through the post? Please let us know if it's got there yet. So it's been now, I reckon, about 5 days. Maybe it takes a bit longer than that. But your Christmas star was sent sort of on, I think it was on Monday this week. All right. Do let us know. News about the mugs. No, we haven't had any done yet. The mugs are being made. I don't know actually if she, I don't think she's done any yet. But we're waiting for a sample mug for me to look at before she starts making all the others. So United Kingdom Talk mugs are on the way. Worry not, my dear. Worry not. JoAnna says, RE the snow, because we're talking about the snow on yesterday's show, and we just fall apart here in the south of the UK whenever there's snow. JoAnna says, it's best for those who don't know how to drive in it should literally stay at home. Absolutely, I agree. Absolutely, they are dangerous on the road. They totally are dangerous on the road. People driving in snow, they shouldn't do it. All right, Joss. Joss is just typing a message. I'm a little bit ahead of myself there, I think. Let's do another little story there. Look at this. Want to stick to your New Year's resolutions? Have you managed to do that? I don't think I... Actually, I haven't weighed myself for a while now. I'm hoping at this point to be under 13 and a half stone. Actually, my scales downstairs tell me 13 stone. And the scales at the gym tell me 13 and a half. So we go by my scales, I think. And I should by now, on my scales, have dropped below 13 stone, I'm hoping. I really am. I want to be 12. You'll know when I'm 12 stone because my face goes a little bit more thin. Anyway, maybe that was your New Year's resolution to do something like that. Researchers have found that moving house could help you stick to your New Year's resolution. You've got to move house, dear. Yes. Habits develop when we repeat behaviours. They are reinforced when things around us stay the same. Now, I can understand this. Do you know, because I've actually managed to lose weight on holiday before. Twice on my two visits to Australia. Well, I got to Australia. Right, I'll try and lose some weight while I'm here. And you do. You can actually. So I can kind of understand this. Researchers based at the University of Bath have found that the habits can be changed when you change the factors around the habit, such as the location and context, which researchers called the discontinuity effect. Discontinuity effect. Christ, dear. Researchers studied the behaviours of 800 people. Half of them had recently moved out and the other half didn't. Some of the participants received intervention promoting better and more sustainable benefit behaviours. So, yes, but where would I move to? I would move to near my sister, I think. I've actually got a plan in place. OK, so around this time next year, what I'd like to do is... try and get my work days together. So at the moment, I've already dropped 2 days at the end of last year, okay? There were reasons I dropped the 2 days, but I wanted to anyway, and I was just waiting for an opportunity. Now, so at the moment, I work Monday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, every other Saturday, sometimes an extra Saturday. What I'd like to do is try and get my days together so I work Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. So I have off Saturday, Sunday, Monday. Now, if I could get those 3 days off together, I could go and visit my sister and things like that, and go on short holidays in caravans all over the place. I might even consider then buying a second-hand caravan, a static one, up somewhere near my sister. Now, actually, that's she lives in Lincolnshire, and one of the places near her where there are hundreds of caravans is Skegness. Now, I'm not keen on the Skegness, the whole seaside thing and all that, right? But just around down the road from Skegness is a place called Mablethorpe, which my sister mentioned to me this week, and my niece is considering going on a little holiday there before she has her next baby, because at the moment she's looking at having a baby. I think it's in April. I think it's going to come, and they want to go somewhere on holiday where it's not too far away from a hospital, because she's had got two children already, and she had a bit of a hard time having both of them. So they want to make sure they're near a hospital this time. And to go somewhere like that would be an idea. So Mablethorpe, that's a consideration, would be to buy a second-hand caravan. I wouldn't buy a new one, they're quite expensive. Up somewhere like that. And then you see, I would finish work on Friday night. I finish at 12 on Fridays. I finish at work on Friday. I could then drive straight there. I'd be there at 3, 3:30 in the morning. Then I've got, I know that sounds funny to you, but that's the time I always drive around, middle of the night. And I could drive up there and have 2 days with my great nieces and great nephews. And of course, my niece and nephew and my sisters. My niece and nephews and my sister as well, for a couple of days, and I could go up there much more often then. And I think that would be quite nice. I would like to try and get a little bit more involved with the little children, really, that are up there. At the moment they're three, two, and one and a bit. That's all their ages at the moment. And of course, there's another one coming as well. And I do have such fun with the little children, and I would like to spend a little bit more time with them. But it would involve trying to get my 4 nights of work together rather than have a day off here, you know, on, off, on, off, on, off. Rather than that, it would be on, off. Now, it might not be possible to do that. It may not be possible to do that, and then the decision would have to be made. Well, should I drop another night so I can at least have 3 nights work together? 1, 2, 3, like that. I don't know how that would work. So that's my little plan, and I'll see how that goes. Josh says, can you let me know whether your old mate has appendicitis? Yes, of course. Well, wait, it'll probably ring in tomorrow. If we do a live show sometime, sort of tomorrow night or something like that might work. Wendy said, oh, what was that? Oh, it's 12 o'clock. 12 o'clock. Look, it's midday. How long have we been chatting for? Oh, we've been here nearly an hour. So yes, it's midday on Saturday now. Wendy says, my dad does. He's in Bridlington. She's got a caravan, Wendy there, Bridlington. I don't know how close that is to where my sister is. Can someone have a look at that for me? Bridlington to Woodhall Spa. What is the distance there? It's got to be about 45 minutes in time or less. Otherwise, it's pointless, you know, doing that. Terry says, my mum has a caravan. She really likes it, and it's great to get away for the weekend. Yeah, do you stay there as well, Terry? And they're very, very comfortable. I know I've gone on and on about caravans on here on this little show so many times now. I don't want to bore you with it, but I really like them. They are home from home, those, especially got the central heating. You know, if you're going to use it in the winter, you need central heating in caravans. Now, I've not yet been in a caravan without central heating. They've all got like a front room fire. They've all got that, but not all of them have central heating. You have to have that specifically. So I think I'd want one with that, especially if I was going up in the winter, you know. Wendy says, stopped making New Year's resolutions. I never stick to them. Oh, do I? I don't know, really. I think sometimes I do, sometimes I don't. Have you got any New Year's resolutions, anyone? Call in and tell me about those today if you want to. 020-8144-3477. You need to be a bit quick. We're only here for another 10 minutes, OK, boys and girls? 020-8144-3477 is my phone-in number. Or if you've got Skype, use the Skype. The Skype in is United Kingdom Talk. The Skype in is United Kingdom Talk. Terry says, I go in the summer. It's at Filey, just south of Scarborough. Is that where I went? Scarborough? In September. Did I go to Scarborough? Where are you going to? Scarborough. Is it Scarborough Fair? Yes, it is. I did go to Scarborough. What a lovely little place that is. Little fishing village and big... Yes, it was Scarborough I went to, was it? It wasn't Scunthorpe, was it? Scarborough. I get confused with the two. They're probably nowhere near each other, are they? Or something like that. Wendy says, oh, Bridlington is about 2 hours from Woodall Spa, so that would be too far from me. Yeah, that would be too far, actually. All right, darling. Hello to Chris Lotz, who sends in an email who says, hello, my friend. It's me, American Chris. That is from the past. I'm now up to your Sunday, January the 8th episode. Oh, come on. I know there's been a lot of shows. I do know the shows have been longer and there's more of them. And people are having trouble catching up. I do apologise for that. But what shall I do? Less shows, dear? We'd like to have a chat. You don't have to watch all of them. But, you know, if you don't, you could miss something very, very important. I know that there's one or two of you that skip through, don't you? You skip through. Well, you can't do that if you're watching live, but you skip through the recordings. Is that wise? You could miss something. Not, you know, you do what you like. Yes, you know. Anyway, he says, I'm now up to your Sunday, January the 8th episode. Still trying to get caught up on your videos. So when I type this email and send it, it will be delivered to the future, January the 5th, 13th. It has indeed been delivered to the future. How strange and mysterious that is. Yes. I have a great 2007 show recommendation for you. What if you have your sister and her husband to do a weekly segment on your show? Think they would be great with their own show. Also, Ronnie would be great with his own segment. However, with Ronnie, you might have to pay him. I beg your pardon. First my sister, then her husband, and now Ronnie as well. You want people to take over my little show here, thy boys and girls? I don't think so, Chris. Not a very good idea, lovey. Not a very good idea at all. No. We can't have people in the studio sharing my show. Where will it all end? You know, if I start with my sister and her husband, and then Ronnie, we'll have people on the phone. Hello, is that Shirley Bassey? Yes, hello, Shirley. Can you come on my show? Why? Why does everyone want to take over my show, dear? No. Not a good idea, Chris. God's sake. I haven't got enough time on here now to say everything I want to say. But thank you for the email, Chris, and the suggestion. Oh, dear, dear me. Good. Now, where are we going now? Just a moment. Here we are. Diets. We're always going on about that. Anyone else want to call in before I close the phone lines? Your last chance to call in, boys and girls. 020-8144-3477 is my number. 020-8144-3477 is my number. Do you remember a few weeks ago I told you that I'd complained to Three because I had a £10 charge on my bill? Do you remember that? That I didn't know where it had come from. And they were really, really helpful. This is the Three telephone network. Really, it was a chap in, probably, I think he was in India. And he was so helpful. He really was. Anyway, they really went the extra mile. And they contacted this number that I'd been charged for. They told me that the charge hadn't come from them. It was supposed to be something that I rang. I don't ever remember ringing it. It turns out it was some sort of charity thing, I believe. Anyway, they contacted them and told them to make sure I wasn't on any sort of repeat thing, because sometimes this is the thing with a lot of this stuff now. You get these reoccurring charges that you don't ever remember signing up to. I don't know if you've had any of those. So they made sure it wasn't a repeat thing. And they also said, are you sure you didn't dial it? I said, I'm not sure. He said, OK, well, also ask for a refund. Well, yesterday, I was sitting in the hairdresser's and I got a text message and it was a refund of £10. What they've done is they've sent me, I haven't done it yet, I'm always a bit late to do it now. I think, what's our post office today? Is it 12 or 1? Is it 12 or 1, the post office on Saturdays? Or it might be 12:30, so I'm going to miss that. I'll have to do it Monday now. But what they do, they've sent me a text message with some sort of code on it. And all I have to do, apparently, is take my phone to the post office with this code on it, and they give me £10 cash back. How fantastic is that? So absolutely top marks there to the three telephone network. I'm very, very pleased about that. Really, really pleased about that. Now, what was the other... the other thing. I was going to buy one of those ring bells. Remember that thing I bought Ronnie for Christmas this year? It's fantastic. It's a little video doorbell. You push the button, and then a camera immediately comes on and starts filming whoever it was who pushed the button. At the same time, within seconds, your phone, mobile phone, rings with that... with that person on there, right? So you can see who's ringing your doorbell. You could be in Australia on the other side of the world. You can see who's ringing that doorbell. Also, you can allow other people to get that phone call. So if, for example, you know, I could say to you, can you be one of my doorbell answerers? You say yes, and I just push a couple of buttons, and then the ring will come up on your phone as well. And you'll be able to see who's calling. Not only that, it also works by movement detection. So if anyone comes within a set area, which you set yourself, then it starts filming them right outside your front door. You know, so you could capture someone who might be snooping around or something like that. Fantastic. I'm considering buying one of those now, but they're not in the Maplin sale, so I'm rather disappointed. I thought I'd wait until the Maplin sale and we'll see if anything comes on there, but it hasn't, unfortunately. So I am considering getting one of those Ring doorbells. Have a look yourself. It's on Amazon as well. Ring doorbells, okay? Ring doorbells. That's what you want there. Let's do today's birthdays, boys and girls. I'll just bring that out. I think we've only got about 3 birthdays today, actually. Where are we? Come on, birthdays. Come back to me. Where are you? There we are. And happy birthday today to Marc-Antony Edon, who's 30 years old today. Happy birthday, Mark. It's been a while since I saw you. Happy birthday, Mark. To Romain Lopez, who's got some very, very nice pictures on his Facebook wall. Thank you very much, Romain. Happy birthday to you, sir. And to Christopher Jinja-Ninja Nedwecki, who it says is 111 years old. Are you a real person, Christopher? I will have to ask you, Christopher, to reply to this show or you will be deleted, because I'm not sure you're a real person. 111 years old? That's a bit us. Even older than some of the people I know, dear. Even older than our great queen. God save our gracious queen. Here comes the song. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Mark, Romain and Christopher. Happy birthday to you. All right? Happy birthday, boys and girls. Oh, is it all boys today? Yes, all boys today. Happy birthday, boys. Have a lovely, lovely time today, okay? Whatever you're doing for your birthday. Tonight, Saturday night, is Saturday the 14th of January 2017. I shall be DJing tonight at Kelly Wilde's birthday party. Kelly Wilde is a singer, cabaret artist. She had a hit in the charts with Gloria. Gloria, all right, long time ago now it was, but she's a fabulous person. And also at her birthday, we're hoping that tonight's going to turn up Angie Brown. You may remember Angie Brown. I'm going to get you, baby. I'm going to get you. Yes, I am. That one. And Rosala. Everybody's free to feel good. Everybody's free. So we're hoping those people might turn up with her this evening as well. That's at Central Station Bar in Wharfdale Road, King's Cross, from 10:30, that little party this evening. Okay. Thank you very, very much for watching and listening. It's an absolute pleasure, as always, to talk to you live here on the show. And I'll see you again very soon. Have a nice Saturday. Cheerio now.